Hey, take two. I'm International Master William Paschall. We're streaming on Twitch and leechess.org. It's Tuesday, the 9th of August. What's up, everybody? Send me some challenges, 5 to 8 minutes with a small increment. We're good. For some reason, every time I try to stream lately, guys, the first launch of the stream fails, and then the second launch of the stream seems to work. M. Havgar, played him before. Might have to challenge somebody because, what can we do here? 5-5, let's challenge a guy to 5-5. Sosolas. So Sosolas from Greece plays the Alekhine's defense. Let's see what we can do. All right, 1947. Classical, over 1,000 games, so he should be pretty legit. Exchange variation. Knight f3 is also good there. I was recommending that to a student of mine. Though the exchange variation is probably one of the most popular. And he does take back with a c-pawn. And I did play this on the stream once before. Welcome, everybody. Should be streaming. Audio, camera, it all looks okay. Last time, I apologize, some worldwide web problems. G6, he does what Nick DeFermian did against me. It was a banter game years ago on World Chess Network, and DeFermian actually played G6. I don't remember what happened, the result of the game, though. I'm pretty sure I didn't lose. He might have drawn, but it was embarrassing, I'm sure, for Nick to overlook Queen D4. So this follows DeFermian, my battle with Nick. Try Bishop E3 here. See if I can get the queen to a useful square quickly. Queen D2. Rather than just like routinely retreat with that idea, but it looks like this guy is all over me with Queen C7 here. That's quite a move. If he takes on c4, I could pin him. But how? Sacrifice a pawn? Can I get away with knight c3? Take, knight e2 just for quick development? I don't know, man. He can't castle kingside, so there's some justification. I think I'd prefer not to sacrifice material here if I don't have to. Because he has such a problem long-term with the rook on g8. Siroche, good morning. You had to choose between weightlifting or chess. It's been a while since I did some weightlifting, I have to admit. Let's consider picking up the heavy chess pieces that Helgi Olofsson plays Blitz with. That's where you can do both, actually, Siroche. You play an Icelandic, old-school Icelandic Grandmaster, you might be able to do both at the same time. We had a session with Helgi Olofsson and Shirazi once, and these pieces are just amazing that he brought. He brings this massive set to the tournament hall. I mean, to the tournament with him. You know, most Grandmasters don't even bother to bring a chess set. Helgi Olofsson brings these pieces that are like the size of... you know, three times the size of a normal regulation set, and they weigh like 600 pounds. That was always a funny memory. Huge advantage if you're not used to it, actually. Here, I'm going to go with development. I could argue for knight d4. But we've got c5, maybe. Sure if that really aids my position, helps my position or not. I'm thinking bishop d3 or bishop e2. Sure, it makes a big difference. I mean, he could play bishop f5, but it's kind of an artificial position. My knight is not great on a3. I have to argue. We are smoothly developed. Black cannot castle kingside. So we're really in good shape here. No, Olufsen has these pieces that are like this big. He's like 6'7". As most Icelanders are tall, Scandinavians in general are taller than most average people from the world. But Helgi Olufsen is particularly tall, and he's got these extra tall, long, giant pieces that he plays blitz with. It's kind of funny. But very cool. So the trash compactor looks like it's on the move here. B3, why not? What else? Sasulas. Knight c5 with the idea of what? Trying to play knight e4? Excuse me. If I play b4 now, just get it moving. Let's get it moving anyway. Queen c2. This I call the trash compactor. I think I made a mistake here. Overlooked something. Nothing major. Fortunate that he played bishop f5, because knight c3 was kind of an awkward move for me. I mean, maybe not the end of the world, but life is still complicated here. Guy is fighting. He's kind of incorrect. G4 might have won a piece there for me, but it was a little bit against my principles to move that pawn in front of my king, but maybe it just wins a piece. Is knight g3 some complications perhaps? Yeah, this trash compactor effect, these four pawns, they seem to be like kind of compacting the queen side spatially. That's why we call it the trash compactor. It hasn't taken effect yet. I mean, you really got to see the c5 get in there for it to really truly be like a trash compactor effect. So, do we get lucky? Or are we still getting bamboozled here? We're still getting bamboozled. Guy has all sorts of nasty tactical tricks. Man. Like, f4 looks like it wins by force, but he has knight g4. Just ridiculous. So I'm just going to play a safe move here. Remember, at the end of the day, he still can't castle. Castle queenside if he wants to. He can be my guest. The castle queenside. Tactical trickster. Move 11. I wish they saved those World Chess Network banters. I guess that was around the time YouTube was starting out. Good question about that, man. I mean, who can you ask nowadays about this site that's like not defunct, but been long gone? Trash compactor is still dangerous looking position for black. B5 even comes to mind here. Opening up the queen side. Kind of a surprise, not the normal trash compactor. But I thought if we open it up with that king on c8, it's just really ugly for black. Bishop b2 and rook c2. As good as anything, I guess. No need to sacrifice any material here. The black king is basically doomed. This is like terrible weaknesses here. The a6 pawn, the c line. He's taking there. So, well, there's just a lot of good moves in this position. One of them is just taking. Queen takes e2, rook c1, rook takes, queen takes, check, but it's not that clear. I wonder if I don't have a better way. You could argue for rook c1 directly. Looks pretty powerful. Kind of a funny variation, king d7 here. Pawn takes pawn, and his queen has to go to b8. That is catastrophic. Queen on b8, king on d7. I play b4. This is a very sensible move. Returning the material. But he's still in a bad way here, ultimately. But this guy, I mean, 1947, he's 1698 in blitz. And he's really defending, I think, credibly. And finally, maybe what you would call a blunder, but maybe this is even an intentional sacrifice. Although c5, bishop b6 wins the exchange, still gives him good defensive chances, but c5 might put him away. Hitting his knight and threatening to open up the c-file. And knight takes c5 loses. So I think this is finally too much for black. Yeah. So he fought a good fight after the opening mistake, but castle and queen side, no safer than like trying to put the king on the king side in the long run. But I thought that he gave me a lot of practical difficulties, and I could have gone wrong. So, thank you for the game, sir. Welcome to the stream, guys. Time to chess. FreshKid526, Glideson, what's up? The trash compactor never took effect. We got Glideson Literatura, Royal Python, new player here. Wow. Okay, I don't think I'm gonna. Let me see. What's that? Rated 8.3 standard. Classical rating over 22 games. That's like barely. That's barely. Morley Suma from I don't know where. I don't know if we're going to accept that rated challenge. You guys got just 22 games. I don't think your rating is very accurate at that point, so I might decline on that rated challenge. Okay, although officially established rating. I might decline the 2422 game player till we see what his rating's like after like 100 games or something like that, you know, something a little more accurate. I'll be glad to play him unrated, though. If you'd like to challenge me to unrated, Morley Suma, but the rated challenge with the 2476 after 22 games, I'm going to take my chances with that and decline. Because we don't know enough about you, sir. Yeah, you would have missed c5 in favor of bishop b6. Yeah, that's the tendency that people have, you know, instant gratification. Larry Christensen was a player I was talking about in reference to a game with a student today, and he's always saying to me, always used to say to me, if you see a good move, there's a pretty good chance there's a better one. And that's a classic kind of situation where that was the case there. Couldn't you take on an f5, William? Time to chess. Yeah, this is a practical decision on my part not to give him counterplay along the g-file. Objectively, you're possibly, most likely, right, but when I don't have that much time, like in these fast games we play on here, to some of you who play Bullet, it may not seem like a fast game, but it is. Trust me. And I'm a player who's played some 7-8 hour games in my career, and 10-minute, 15-minute chat is still a fast game. The thing is, when I don't have enough time, you know, to analyze things out, I'm going to avoid any kind of situations where there's a hint of kind of counterplay from my opponent. So I'm just not taking on f5 because I just didn't want to open the f file for my opponent there. Okay, now f3. What do we have here, guys? Luke McShane, it looks like. Grandmaster Luke McShane actually played this against me when he was still a young punk without a real title. When he was FM Luke McShane. F3. He was like FM Luke McShane, 2150. Played F3 against me. So it's... I think this is the known trap here. Queen B4. GM Nike. Oh. Most of the top people in Classical have roughly 30 to 40 games total played in Classic. Well, you can call them top people if you like. But I think that none of the top people in my mind have 30 to 40 games. But sooner or later... Yeah, I think you were playing on somebody else's account already against me. So... That's cool, dude. Bishop to B3... The top people are the people that play like thousands of games, not like 30 or 40. And keep changing accounts. Get an identity and defend your identity, you know? So this is the Luke McShane game. Been a long time since I played this. He actually swindled a draw against me years ago. It's not that easy for black to win. I think you win a pawn here. There are a couple of complicated variations. Yeah, no respect for people who play on other people's accounts. Definitely not good sportsmanship. Time to chess. Great point. Always suffer the syndrome of instant gratification. Yeah. No, I'm not going to play. It's most likely my issue is with it being a computer, dude. I'm not going to sit here and go with, like, a 20-player game. A player who's played 20 games when they're very possibly a computer. I don't have time to sit here and go over their games, decide whether they're not computer or not, you know. It would take me, like, 20 minutes to figure that out, so. Knight takes c6. Bishop takes c3 check. And this is... Again, we are in McShane-Paschall mode. Book trap. So instant gratification, yeah, never good. Can you save the game, Gleitson? Like the young Luke McShane. I did torture him for quite a long while. So guys, welcome to my stream. You can also check out my videos, video chess training, on YouTube. Last stream got a little bit problematic with some internet issues. Sorry about that. But I think it was across the board. And so now, this is the vital moment. Black has to, rather than take with the b-pawn, take with the d-pawn here. The idea is that if pawn takes e4, this happens. Instant gratification, Gleitson. Instant gratification. So, bishop d4, and the idea there is that I can play e5. If we look at this position, guys, this is McShane-Paschall years ago. Bishop d4, e5. With the idea of bishop takes queen, knight takes queen check. And very good position for black. So, that's possibly in the chess database somewhere. I'm not really sure. But it's a trap that other players fell into long before McShane did, I'm sure. It's a known trap. We're not doing a simul today. We're definitely playing most challengers who have an established rating and identity. King f2, bishop takes d4. Now I can afford to give some material back if I wanted to. But I don't think it's necessary. Castles looks fine. And my queen has retreat to a5. Fresh Kid said, interesting line, but where is the trap? You're just winning a pawn if played correctly. Well, that is the trap, man. He fell for f3, queen b4. And that's a trap. He fell into the trap. Definition of trap. So Gleitson is not one to resign early. Stefanos, yeah, we've played before, right? I've got challenges from Royal Python, Gorkum Kurt, Blar Twitch. And that's 83 games is enough for me, man. I don't want to play people rated 2,500 with 20 games. So we avoided this GM guy who likes to pump up his ego by beating people with random accounts or something. That's interesting. I suspected more like it might have been a computer, but maybe we sidestepped the crazy GM. All right. C5, C4, anybody? Somehow McShane got into an ops-colored bishop ending against me a pawn down. It was like ops-colored bishops and rooks. And I couldn't finish him off, just didn't have a good enough technique. He was already showing a lot of talent at the age of like 12 or 13, whatever it was when I played him. All right, now what's up here? I think we're very close to winning further material with c4. Yeah, we played an assignment. You're welcome for the game, Stefanos. We'll play anything between 5 and 8 minutes with a small increment. You see, I don't really want to play bigger than the 8-3, longer than 8-3. So if it's an 8-minute base time, then just 3-second increment. And if you want to play a more blitz game, more blitz time control game, then let's trap this bishop, man. Can we trap this bishop? A blitzier game would be like 5-5-3, 5-4, 5-5, if you like. Anything in between. Anything in between 5-3 and 8-3, more or less. So, well, eventually I'm going to win some material here, I think. Queen d2 check. As crafty as Gleitson is, you're taking that bishop off the board. This bishop is trapped. Like a bug in a rug. Gorkum Kurt is challenging us. Royal Python. Emmanuel Jorge, you're challenging us to 7-0, but I'd like you to change that to an incremental time control. So we can talk about the game and really analyze it. So if you hear me, Emmanuel Jorge, you need to make it like 7-2, 7-3, or 5-3, or whatever you want. Dark Amen Tla, or Tia. Tla. You play anyone who challenges you during your streams? Well, not anyone. Most anyone. We avoid rated players with suspicious accounts. People who might be using computers. But 90% of the time, we're going to play anybody who challenges us. Yes, rating is not important. So we're cleaning up this game. Gleitson is not a guy who likes to resign. But this position is really beyond hope. So Royal Python had some suggestions. Not sure. I had queen f6, queen a6. Didn't see that. Instead of a6. I guess it's neither here nor there. I mean, this is really... One thing I wanted to say about chess on Lee Chess and the evaluation of the centipawn loss and stuff. I wanted to comment on that because the other day I was thinking, you know, it's kind of ridiculous. I mean, there are certain games where, you know, you played like a perfect game and then you're up like 5 points of material, but your centipawn loss like goes out the window because, you know, you didn't like do the move that like is making you like up 10 points of material. Like the position is just totally, totally beyond like a doubt over. And your like centipawn loss goes from, I don't know, you know, from 10 to like 30 because you didn't like win an additional rook or something. I mean, there ought to be like a kind of cutoff there that once the position reaches a certain point and never goes below like 5 pawns up or something, I don't think we can really criticize the players. It's kind of like running up the score in a sporting match or something. It's not necessary to like humiliate the other guy and take all of his pieces. Dr. Checkmate. Hello, Bill. How's it going? Dr. Checkmate, welcome. King Shulamov. John Bartholomew posted a video saying that playing too many short time controls like Bullet Blitz do not teach lower-rated players much. Would you say 10-0 games on Lee Chess? Absolutely, man. I mean, that's what I do here, you know? That's what I do. That's totally my philosophy as well. I don't know, you know, John Bartholomew that well. I don't really know him. I mean, I've played, like, next to him in a tournament, but you know, he seems like pretty, you know, pretty good guy, pretty good player, and sensible. If I wasn't supporting myself, you know, I'd say he looks like one of the better streamers. I don't want to like compliment my competition too much, but he seems like the kind of guy who knows what he's talking about. All right, Emmanuel Jorge says, thanks for talking about lines. I only like to play Sicilian. Gorky says, but you can blunder when you have 5 pawns up or miss some crazy tactics. Yeah, I agree, Gorky. Yeah, there's no clear like answer to this whole thing, but I'm just kind of like, you know, what, have 5 pawns up, then 10 pawns up, or make draw the line somewhere, but it really doesn't matter if you play perfectly when you're up like 8 points of material or something. Okay, maybe 5 points up. Yeah, you can hang your rook. I mean... But I think the people who pay attention are understand what I'm saying. Emmanuel Jorge, please change the challenge to like 7-3 instead of 7-0. Something like that. And Blar Twitch, I don't think you... I don't remember if you were challenging me to a non-increment game there earlier. But also the same thing with Blar Twitch. I need to have an increment so we can kind of talk about the games as we play through them. Dr. Checkmate used to work with him and Brian Wall back in the day on Chess FM. Wow. Dr. Checkmate. You could only be one of a few people. You had the honor of working with me and Brian Wall on Chess FM. E4, C5. Well... I mean, we did have a lot of commentators on Chess FM. Dr. Checkmate could be one of the other commentators, or he'd be somebody who worked with production of Chess FM on ICC. But I don't know. Brian Wall. Getting tired of this game. Good resignation, Glideson. Royal Python. All right, man, bring it. You said I would play E5. Did I say that today? I had a student who faced Bishop C4 in a game I was studying today, so I kind of thought that'd be interesting. Wow, open Sicilian. Dark Amantia, you only accept A3? No, that's just the favorite challenge of a lot of people, because it's the longest time control that I'll play. So if you want to have a long game, the A3 is the longest time control I play on my streams. Dr. Checkmate, I probably know who you are, but I'm not going to reveal your identity. Dr. Checkmate is a good guy. All right, So knight c3. Good to have you here with us, Dr. Checkmate. Long time no see. Please give me any tips, William. Well, Glideson, I mean, you just fell into it like a book trap there. Not really anything to criticize you for. Moving too quickly with f takes e, you know? Masters just don't give away pieces. So I think when you're in that kind of situation and you think you're just winning a piece against a strong player, you really need to take your time and say, look, man, I mean, this guy's a decent player, and he's not going to just give me a piece for free. So when you capture it on e4, you just sort of look, you know, you didn't look before you were leaping. And anytime there's any question, like, you can win something, this guy's a decent player, what's up here? You've got to ask yourself, don't jump, you know, at that, like, really, like, greedy material win. Check and double check what's going on. So you just jump too quickly there. Knight g4. So, Royal Python, welcome to the Karaklage, man. Karaklage passed away. He was a Serbian theoretician. Number of years ago. I think somebody else played this against me on the stream as well. If I play g6 here, I wonder if... he gets a lot of counterplay. G6, knight takes knight, pawn takes knight, e5, bishop g7, pawn takes pawn, queen takes pawn. That would be like one structural way for white to play. E6 is no doubt like a completely solid move. Safest move. G6. Knight takes knight, pawn takes knight, e5, bishop g7, and now pawn takes d6, castle's out there. I have to take with the queen. Got a great bishop, but he has like better structure. So should I do that or should I just play e6? I'm kind of leaning toward just playing e6, not giving him that structural, that clear structural plan. That he has there after g6, knight takes knight, e5. Although, maybe I could play like d5 in that instance instead. So now, quick castle queen side. Is white threatening anything? Good question. Bishop e7, knight to b5. A6, knight takes d6, check, bishop takes d6, and another knight to b5, and I'm hating life there. So it looks like the answer is yes to that question. He's threatening stuff. So I probably should play a6. Just, I think, very strange lines. Well, Glideson, you did a typical thing. You know, you probably have seen like classical games against the normal dragon Sicilian, and you wanted to just transpose to a setup that you're familiar with. Baron Ulfer, what's up? Welcome. Blauer said, you should play a bit more quicker games so you can play more different players. Stream also gets more interesting. Blart, there are plenty of streamers who do that, you know. So you can check them out. But I'm in this to, like, try to help people to improve in chess and not to just, like, play, you know, bullet and really fast blitz games where the quality of the game is really low. So that's just my philosophy. You can definitely find other players who are willing to play, like, 5 minute and faster. But I don't think the quality's there. You're not really learning that much from it. So entertainment value, you know, if you want entertainment value, there are places to go to watch. But something a little deeper where we can learn something is what I'm kind of aiming for. All right, bishop d3. Queen b6 here is definitely a candidate move. But I have lots of moves. Bishop d3 is a bit odd. There's temptation to try to, like, win material with some tricks, maybe e5. But I would surrender a lot of squares if I do that kind of thing. I read somewhere the dragon was refuted. I don't think so, Dr. Checkmate. Although it's a very difficult opening to play. As Carlson has played it successfully in recent years on other people. Kasparov played it. Royal Python, Queen B6. Yeah, I mean, it would force you to retreat with, like, bishop somewhere again, but I'm not sure what my follow-up... Yeah, they should have a follow-up, though. Maybe Queen B6. Queen B6, Knight F5. I just trade queens. A slightly better ending. Chekmatov, little tactics with pawn on e5. Yeah, there are little tactics here, but we've got to be careful not to give up squares. I really, you know, believe that this bishop is a huge asset for black long term in the ending. Budvinik proved this in countless, you know, Sicilians and stuff. So if you watch games of top grandmasters, it's kind of a situation. It's not like a no-brainer, but I mean, black is clearly better once he gets that dark-squared bishop. So, he does go for the trade of queens. And position is still playable for white. There's some idea of knight c4. So we want to slowly sort of strangle white here. I think b5 takes away the square c4, which is pretty valuable. Zeldamber, is there any other chess streaming site? Well, I mean, people do stream through YouTube and Twitch. Probably others as well. But for my purposes, this is just fine. So we're looking at an ending now. White has a significant amount of weaknesses. And the saying goes that in the Sicilian, if white, you know, doesn't land a direct attack successfully, he's usually worse in the ending. I think that's going to be the case here. Royal Python just keeps coming with the pawns, but there's no threat of, like, checkmating me realistically anymore. So I'm not sure if he should keep extending his pawns here or not. I don't feel threatened with the queens traded off the board. I mean, fundamentally, there are a lot of tactics, but e5 would give up the d5 square. Without even calculating, I think you can just base your evaluation on some kind of positional factors as well. So it looks like Python wants to just advance all these pawns. Not really. I think I'd like another square for my bishop to retreat, maybe, to f8. I'm not sure it's absolutely necessary, though. Would like to have more time. He's playing very fast. But if white plays f5, I have knight e5 available. g6 looks kind of weakening. Maybe just set up my rooks in the center. Rook f8, rook e8, or sorry, rook d8, rook fe8. White playing very quickly, though. White's pawn's overextended a little bit. He has to be careful. I prefer black. He's playing very quickly lately. After rook f1, I'm thinking about playing g6, but it still is... It's a tiny bit weakening. So I think I prefer something more classical here. This is unrated, but Royal Python is a very competitive player. He's got a lot of draws and a win against me. Fairly fast. Yes, some threats with the space there, but in the long term, I think the pawns could turn out to be weaknesses. That's what usually happens. So, trying to save this for later. Trying to save time for later, he said. Yeah, that's an interesting thing. It's pretty hard to save time with 3 second increments, man. That is pretty hard to do. Look at this knight g4, man. He is crazy, like, very original player. I've got to be careful. He's just trying to expand, and looks like a tough move to meet, actually. I don't know here. Maybe knight b4 and d5 or something. But knight b4, d5, he has a3 at the end. So I'm not really sure. What do I do? Bishop f8 kind of weakens certain squares. It's not that easy for black here. Not that easy. Pretty amazing kind of setup for white in this position. Really strange position. Maybe knight d4? Strange move to play knight d4. I'm just getting kind of low on time. We have tactical threats. He tries to play f5. Take, bishop f3, maybe. Wanted to open up my bishop. My knight is not vulnerable to anything on d4. Chess for life, 2-3. My intuition said rook c8 instead of rook d8. Why do you prefer rook d8? It's in the center. I want to try to break with d5 at some point. But rook c8 is just as good a candidate, I guess. You may be right about rook. You may be right about rook c8. Problem is, if I play bishop f8, the f6 square gets kind of weak. So, what do we do here? Hard to say. D5, maybe. Central break. Looks like white's got a lot of space. He's playing this perfectly. Now he's threatening f5. And this could be dangerous for black, actually. So I best be careful. Maybe white is better here. Not much time. He's got a 2 minute time advantage. White is better now. Played this extremely well. Positionally, his space advantage is maybe even winning. Close to winning. Bishop b5. I don't know about that move. What it does exactly. Bishop b5 seemed like kind of a cheap threat. But he's outplayed me. It's always tough to decide where to put the rooks. I mean, both c8 and d8 were reasonable candidates. Sometimes the d6 pawn is weak, although in that particular position, it wasn't really about that. I just thought I could push d5 at some point to have some control in the center. And white has this massive space advantage on the king side. It looks like a bad, like a French where white has the advantage. H6, of course. Now I'm really, now I really regret that I didn't play that that way. King H8 is interesting. Really getting low on time. Royal Python plays, he seems to be getting stronger. Every time I play him, honestly. Probably after a big layoff, not playing chess for a long time, he's getting his power back. And seems to be playing Master Strength in this game. Though the opening is totally inferior for white to give up that important piece, basically. I really have to close it up here, though I don't like it. I don't see an option. Close it up and hope that I can hold on. I don't have to take that knight. I do have to be careful about it, though. Is it going to do any damage? I don't see any immediate damage it can do. I'm kind of hoping I could take it at the right moment. Both getting really low on time here. So, tough position. Looks like a French tarash or something. I just made an inferior move. I don't think rook c7 was the best. We start, you know, we start making some mistakes, and the time gets down. And we're thinking about the clock rather than the position. This is what I missed. So Python, after playing like a positional genius, he finally succumbs to a tactical mistake. Now I don't mind trading. Still not easy to make progress. How's my king gonna get out? Yeah, rook c4 maybe. He lost on time. Now, man, tough game. Blar Twitch, you still, and Emmanuel Jorge are not changing your challenges, dude. I'm not gonna accept the non-incremental challenges, guys. So, Emmanuel Jorge, if you want to play, dude, you gotta replace your challenge with an increment challenge, like 7-3, 5-3, 7-4, something like that. Because I'm not gonna accept those challenges. All right, so e4. Gorkum Kurt, we have played another game in the modern defense. You play fast and still lose on time. Well, I'm experienced and I don't lose my composure when I get low on time. I mean, we all do at some point, but I'm pretty good at keeping my composure in time pressure over the years. So, well, it was unpleasant for black, that position. Wait, last time Gorkum Kurt played something slightly unusual, I believe. I looked it up later, and it was also a Peart's classical variation. I looked it up later and somebody else had played this line. Played knight c6 here. This is very experimental. Now he's playing c5. I don't believe that's normally played. That seems wrong to me. But what's the reason why? I can't remember. Take e5. What could be the answer here? I mean, d5 just transposes to like a normal Schmid Bononi type position. It's an option for white. If I don't play d5, let him exchange, it'll be a dragon, like a kind of lame sort of dragon. As far as I recall, I'm supposed to take here, but I don't remember. I don't remember the follow up here. Nobody ever plays c5 against me. It must be a variation. Maybe bishop e3. Maybe not e5, maybe bishop e3 is interesting. Because e5, knight g4, bishop f4, knight c6, and I don't see how that's in white's favor. So I guess attacking this pawn. Makes some sense, although black could play queen a5 here. What about trading queens and then bishop e3? And then going for the open file? This looks kind of lame. By the way, this guy, Gorkum Kurt, and he's got 1,100 games in Blitz, but in classical he's extremely strong against me. I don't think I won. I did win one game. He's got an even score against me, 2,200. That's pretty good, man. I mean, which rook do I want to move here? Get off the long diagonal? Possibly some kind of minimal advantage for white. Without just taking the file. DST, Sledgey, for the OTB Standard Tournament, you went to beat a 2086, a 2105 WFM, and a 2214 rated player. Nice job, man. Nice job. How did you feel like playing long games as a bullet player? Was it a handicap, or did you beat these people on time? Doesn't black equalize after queen exchange? I don't know, Stefanos, but I'm not sure. I can't recall like what the theory is supposed to be here. If I have an advantage, it's like absolutely minuscule. So let's trade rooks, get his knight on the back rank. Yeah, he's got threats of bishop b7, putting pressure on my center. Doesn't look like I got anything here. e5, knight g4. Bishop b7 is a threat. Looks like black just did equalize. Rook d1. Insta moves. Hard to argue with bishop b7, although knight e6 and knight c6 were candidate moves. What's going on? e5? Not sure about this. Looks like I might be overextending myself. But Gorkum Kurt, man. I mean, how can you be like 1900, dude, in bullet and play like this? Like this perfectly. It's getting a little too strong, man. I mean, you're a little too good for your rating. Bishop f4. I normally just eat like 1900 blitz players for lunch, dude. I mean, anybody who's 1900 in blitz would be like, I'm probably even stronger in the slower time control than I am in blitz, so I don't understand why I can't beat you, sir. H3. Yeah, get him off my pawn there. You did lose to an IM2460. You lost to some strong players. What's this? It was really boring. They had drawn positions and they wanted more. Then they all blundered. What was your rating, by the way, DST? Do you want to reveal that? What's your actual rating is? Do we get re-challenged? Blur Twitch did not change his challenge. He doesn't care. Emmanuel Jorge isn't listening. He challenged me to 10-1. No, dude, I don't play 10-1. The longest time control I play is 8-3, and we need at least a 3-second increment. I don't play longer than 8 minutes. You guys have to pay attention if you want to play. Camel Clutcher's back. Camel Culture, I called him. Now, Knight H6. Gorkumkurt has made some mistakes in games against me, but usually he finds some resourceful way out of any kind of trouble he gets himself into. Knight H6 doesn't look like I'm in any immediate danger here. Rook D7. It's like Knight F5. And I don't know. I mean, it's my... Also have Knight D5. That's probably either going to be met by Knight C6 or King F8. Rook D7, Knight F5, Knight D5 variation. He always has Knight E6 at some inconvenient moment as well. Got the open file. But is it enough? You beat me only in the simul. He said he beat me only in the simul. Not a victory for me. You're in trouble in that. But you've been tough every single game, man. I'm impressed. Rook D7. So, under 1900 standards. So these guys, that's a classic problem. I mean, you got to be very, very careful not to underestimate anybody. And I think now with the internet, the way it is, people like DST who are Master Strength and Blitz lurking around. This is a trap. What's this? I can take the pawn. Where's the trap, man? I mean, I can take this pawn. And then you're going to trap me with like 96. Looks like he's going to trap me with 96 or something like that. So that's some kind of exchange sacrifice. Rook takes e7, 96. I have bishop takes h6 there. Bishop takes h6. My rook is trapped, though, effectively. So it's a little dangerous to take this pawn. I don't know that my rook is getting out. He also has bishop f8 right away. Although then I have rook c7. This is really tough. Rook c7 is an option. Then bishop takes f3. Man, this is just tough. I don't know. I'm going to lose if I take that pawn. It looks like... capitulation to give up that easily there. Rook c7, just staying on the 7th rank. Alright, looks a little dangerous. Look too dangerous to take this pawn. I'm going to lose an exchange. So, disco motive. Pawn too tempting, must take. Well, if you have a computer to help you analyze, that may be the case. But rook takes e7 to me. I mean, I just see 96 and my rook has no squares. Then the only thing I could think about would be like giving up the exchange for a pawn. That's the best I could find when I was analyzing. So I don't know, guys. My rook is stuck out there. Let's play king f1. Bishop is a bishop, but the knight is powerful too. So, I mean, I think this guy is worth the white squared bishop. In terms of overall value, I don't mind like giving up my bishop for his knight. It's tempting to play something like bishop c4, but he's still got a knight in a very, very dangerous forward position there. We have e6, trying to break up his pawn chain. Which is interesting. A lot of moves, though. Knight e4. centralizing. Is my rook going to get out of there? Is the problem. We can go to rook c7 if we have to. This rook may well have to go here. We're trying to centralize. I could have played e6. Probably passing up that. Although he has bishop takes c3 there. I'm not. Now this is. This is getting a little bit scary now. Rook c7. Or e6. E6 now? E6 now is kind of complicated. My rook is getting trapped here. Rook c7. King d8. Rook b7. Seriously? I guess we'll play e6. I mean, I don't want my rook to get trapped. And he insta-played f5. This is kind of weird. You're not a blitz player, but you make a lot of quick moves, man. Knight c3. You got a three-minute time advantage here. And you're like, making me suffer, feels like. I don't know who's better here. Maybe I'm better, but it was very, very precarious. I was a little worried he could take on b2, and he didn't do it in that position. Espresso Forever, what's up, man? Rook takes e7, knight e6, bishop takes, bishop takes, bishop c4. That's what I analyzed, time to chess. And then he plays bishop f8, and my rook's trapped. So I have to sacrifice the exchange. And I didn't know, you know, if I have enough there. If I had more time, I would think about going for it. But when I don't have enough time, my default is to kind of like avoid complications. That is definitely not avoiding complications. That's pretty complicated, like giving up an exchange for unclear compensation. Wow, is he melting down here? Not necessarily. It looks like maybe black is defending. Knight's in a very bad position. But it looks like he can hold on. Very strange game today. Rook on the 7th. Tying him down to e7. Knight's in a bad position there. Finds this move. It's pretty impressive, man. But I have knight e5, knight f6, knight c6 with a double attack. And I don't know what else to do. It's going to be kind of murky. Really murky. Yeah, this looks like excellent play by black. After king g7, I have to be careful. Not sure what the best move is. It's probably knight d7. I don't want to let him free himself. Knight c6 would be a big mistake. I mean, king f6, take on a7, king takes e6. Probably black's better there with a better structure. So I'm much better off on g5. Wow. I don't know what's up with that. I see, okay. Alright. I'm gonna need to use my king, probably. I feel like I'm fighting against a stronger player. I don't know how to put that different way, but... king here? I feel like I'm fighting against a very strong player. Against Gorkum Kurt. But I guess, theoretically, I'm better. Just, it's always nerve-wracking playing against him. So tough. All the time. So resourceful. Alright. Time trouble. Time trouble for me, man. 94. Well, like king takes f5 here. You think I would get something against his king? Dominating the knight if it's on f2. I mean, interesting move here, knight f6. He's setting up mating nets. I'm not convinced. I'm not convinced that I'm winning here. Knight d5 now? Very powerfully placed pieces. Monster king. This pawn would like to promote. But I can't afford to lose my h-pawn here. So we got to keep him tied down. Knight h3. Where are you going? Where are you going? You must have a plan there. I'm just grabbing pawns randomly. Ultimately winning the A pawn. I have to be careful not to be too slow. He's gone after my H pawn. All right. Doesn't get much more difficult to like take out a 1900 player. I mean, he's 2200 in classical technically. Then this game. Look at this. Defense, man. Unbelievable. Dude, you play like at least 2300. You're 2200. It's just based on 20 games. I don't understand why your blitz rating is so low, dude. You can play this well. Just doesn't make sense. Okay. Now, he didn't take the pawn. What am I doing here? King g6? Wow. All right. Trying to keep him paralyzed. No time to even think here. Incredible. Well, that was a blunder. He missed knight d6 check. And dude, there's no way you're 1900 in blitz, man. I mean, that's insane. All right. How do I make progress here? I thought you'd play knight c7 check and knight a8 there. Incredible game, man. I mean, how can you be 1900? That is an incredible effort by Black that I never should have won. Only winning because of time pressure at the end. Great play by Black overall. A lot of resourceful stuff. So I'm just lucky to win. Completely lucky. I could have even lost. All right, Stefanos 2200 8-3. Cosine says, "What's up? Hi." He makes mistakes, man. But every time he makes a mistake, for every mistake he makes, he finds two amazing moves. Just really, you know, master strength blitz player, in my opinion. I don't know how he can possibly be 1900 in blitz. All right, Stefanos, we played only once. That was a tough game. You tried to kill me. I recall. You missed a lot of chances, I'm sure, man. You probably had a draw for sure, pretty easily. You had me in time pressure most of the game. Dr. Weedaholic says, chess, nothing for me, just know the rules. All right, man. Well, that's how we all started. In the beginning, I just thought, like, you take all the pieces and it's like checkers or something. That's how I went through elementary school. But once I hit seventh grade, I figured out, you know, that there's more to it than checkers. And that's the beginning of a great part of my life. Yeah, that game should be a draw. But I just feel like Gorky is a really talented but not consistent player, but he's every single game I played against him, it's like pulling teeth to try to take him out, you know. And normally it's like falling out of bed beating someone with his blitz rating. A 1900 is usually very easy for me to take out. Okay, so Stefanos, it's a London system kind of defense against the King's Indian. I went back to my roots here with knight f3. In the spring, if anybody here was following me, all spring I was like preparing for this tournament in Zalakaros, Hungary. And I was playing a repertoire based on knight f3 and c4. Lately, I've been playing more e4, and I sort of reverted back to my safe repertoire here. Stefanos is 2200. I'm not sure, you know, that I don't know too much about him. So he has 2 games, 29 games, 1800 in blitz. Okay, so actually, he's sort of similar, but with many less games than the last opponent. I thought he did defend great, man. I mean, he made mistakes, but he also made great moves, too. He found, like, knight g8 in a position where it was the only move, you know. This backward move, knight g8, that's not an easy move to find. You know, the average player, expert strength player, doesn't find that automatically. I mean, so, yes, he made a lot of mistakes, but he also made a lot of great moves. And he seems very tough. C4. But that's we get a lot of tough players here. Camel Clutcher, what happened, man? Are you in my list? Oh, you're next. Okay. Camel Clutcher, the Grandmaster X, is challenging me to 8-3 rated. I'm not going to play. He'll come on the stream and criticize me. Emmanuel Jorge, is now at 8-3. Thank you, Emmanuel. Blar Twitch didn't change his challenge. He just wants to play 5-0. And Demonolith is challenging me to 8-3. You guys don't have to challenge me to 8-3. I mean, I will play like 5-3 or 6-3. I mean, I think that there's this impression here that I only play 8-3. Provoking queen b3 could end badly. How so, provoking queen b3? Kramnik, I think, is playing d3 in this position. I gotta be honest with you guys. I didn't mean to play d3. I mean, I meant to play queen b3. That's what I've usually been playing. B3 is like an old move too, going to a real rati system. But d3, I think that black can take on c4. It's not really that well known of a line, but the games that I've seen, black did fine. You know, take, and black trades queens or whatever. So I think, Stefanos, that's something to seriously consider, to play d take c there, even though it kind of goes against classical principles. Future chess GM, how late do you have to start a chess to not become a GM? This is like weird backward question. I was thinking 30. It would be pretty hard to start after 30, beyond 30, and become a GM. But it's all going to like depend on, like, you know, if you're just an absolute, you know, mind-boggling genius. I mean, you're probably going to be able to do it if you can devote the time to it at any age. The thing that holds people back isn't their age, it's the responsibilities that they have, like, you know, accumulated in their life. So it doesn't mean that, like, 40-year-old players can't play as well as 20-year-old players, but usually those 40-year-old players have, like, 3 children, they're working, like, a full-time job, so the chances are they're not going to play as well as, like, a student who's 20 years old. It's not as much about the actual age. So I think, you know, you could start fairly late at, like, 30 and still become a GM. If the guys at your chess club say you're too old, that's absolutely bullshit. That's absurd. I mean, they might argue that you're too old to become, like, world champion or something. And I think they could be right about that in today's world. But don't listen to people that say that. They're just, like, haters. There are plenty of people who told me I couldn't even become an IM because I didn't start chess until I was, like, 13, basically. There'll always be people like that, so just ignore them. I mean, that's just typical, like, hater mentality. Totally not true. Do not listen to that. Knight d4 here is a move that I could play, theoretically, but I don't think it really achieves anything. So when I regain my composure, I think this is the move. I played actually a game against, it is all coming back to me. I played a game against Grandmaster Laszlo Gonda with Bishop e3. This is what Romanishin plays. Maybe it wasn't the same position though. I think that actually Gonda had the knight on d7 instead of Bishop e7. That's more standard. To have the bishop on f8 and the knight on d7. That might actually be important here. Maybe bishop e3 is really good now. Because you don't have the knight on d7. So slightly improved. It's not like it's earth-shaking, like, crushing advantage to white, but because the knight's on d7, he can play bishop c5, bishop takes c5, knight takes c5. Romanishin has played this for white. Gonda for black. It's probably close to equal, but white has a minimal advantage. Dude, that's just a hater, man. Don't listen to that kind of person. I would never ever talk to that person again. This is absolutely absurd. This person knows nothing about what they're talking about. Anybody, you know, with a great trainer and money, or even not money, just time, I mean, could easily become an FM if they're above average intelligence, you know. You have to have some basic components, but, you know, if you're above average intelligence, you have the resources, the right training, there's no reason that the average intelligent individual can't get to FM level, even from the age of 30, but probably higher. Yeah, it's just, don't pay attention to that kind of thing. This person is just, like, bitter because they didn't achieve something, or Who knows? Exactly. Like W Rex said, yeah, they're definitely like angry they didn't achieve something. I had a similar kind of thing that a guy said to me, and later he admitted he was wrong, obviously in the face of reality, but it was the same kind of thing. A person who was bitter because they like didn't achieve what they wanted to achieve. Anyway, guys, welcome to my stream. My name is International Master William Paschall. I'm here to entertain you, but more importantly, try to teach you to play some good chess. So, what do we got here? Knight A6 and tactical possibilities based on the knight A6. He's also tied down to A7, which is a pawn that actually, it's sometimes a little awkward to actually take that pawn because pieces can get trapped and whatnot. Yeah, I'm thinking knight d4 here. The maneuver that I did mention earlier, and we've got knight takes c6. This is the first trap, or tactic, I should say, not trap. And there's a few points to note that the knight defends the e2 pawn in case of bishop g4. We could play an intermezzo like h3. Obviously, c6 is a pretty vital part of his pawn chain. So it looks pretty problematic. Plus, I'm hitting his bishop, which would shatter his pawn structure to a fair degree. Yeah, don't put any stock in people who discourage you. If you're under the age of 30, I mean, you can achieve very much in pretty much any field. Again, with the right amount of time and resources, there's just no question. So, my question is, can I make GM? That's a little tougher, but I just need like 120 rating points and three norms. So, knight to d4. Black with a few inaccuracies, probably bishop e7, slightly inaccurate. Yeah, I'm gonna snap this, and we have a big edge. Hitting the bishop on e7, we're hitting a7, we're winning a pawn. Maybe it's lights out. I don't see a lot of counterplay for black here. Plus, he's got, additional weaknesses. And my development's almost finished. I mean, I just need to play knight c3 or knight d2 and double rooks. So greedy or not to be greedy here. It's a pretty important pawn on c6. The a7 pawn, I'm not as convinced about. So if I play rook takes c6, he can play rook b8. And then knight d2, bishop b4. Then I move my knight again, like knight f3 or something like that. Probably good enough. I like the c pawn. So, holding on to the pawn. And I could play c5, but that would overextend my pawns a bit. So I guess we activate the last piece. And what about some kind of prophylactic move for white here? Could play bishop f4. That's pretty disruptive, actually. h3. Taking away the g4 square. Now he plays bishop b4. He's not threatening. Maybe knight h5 is a threat. So g4 makes sense. e5 is also a threat. Yeah. Could sack a piece. Yeah, but I think I'm better off just completing development here. And we have another way we could try to hold the pawn with bishop e5 now. It's not going to last forever, though. Bishop e5. What am I talking about anyway? Never mind. I think I meant knight d4, but I'm starting to have strange hallucinations. Anyway, knight d4. Maybe I'm going to too many extremes to try to keep this pawn on b3. Too much of an extreme to keep the pawn. But one thing, don't try to win on time, guys. Notice how I'm not trying to flag him. Because that's a big mistake, honestly. Now he gave up this pawn. I'm gonna take with this guy. I guess. Try to hold on to my two extra pawns. Don't try to flag him. It's a big mistake with increment. 3 second increment. You really can't flag people. And so we win material, more material here. The white squared bishop on a long diagonal. He lost the rook. So it's, yeah, that's it. He's gonna let the clock go out on that one. Thank you, Stefanos. So again, I'm not gonna play this guy. He was 2491, just 29 games. It's like a guy who tries to take over multiple accounts and turn them into 2600s. Emmanuel Jorge, he got the right challenge in there. Come back when you have 100 games, dude. And you're like 2800, and I'll play you. Emmanuel Jorge, 1842, playing 8-3. I love it when I get a time triple, and then it's actually the opponent who starts to move super quickly. Yeah, that's the thing. Playing 4 people's time trouble is a big mistake. And it was still a mistake even when there was no increment. A lot of people would screw up even when there was no increment. But now with increment, you know, I think with a 1 second increment, you can still play for time. But with more than that, I mean, forget about like trying to play for time. Cosine says he really wants to get back into OTP chess. OTB chess. Me too, man. I only play in the Hungarian Team Championship and one recent tournament. BG5, this is a pretty rare move. So, Queen A5 check looks like a solid move. Although, Queen E2 there probably leaves White with a small edge. We could play CD. And I think I had a similar game to this recently. C takes D, knight takes D4. Can't remember. Saji, where's the beard? Balarao, you haven't been here for a while. Beard has been missing for a while. Pawn takes pawn. Knight takes pawn, knight E4. That would be a funny variation. A little too fancy. How can I take advantage of this bishop on g5? It's not so easy. I mean, queen b6 would become a kind of Blumenfeld gambit type position. That's playable. Risky for black. CD looks kind of conforming. I think I played this in another game, CD. Queen a5 check just not looking great. After queen e2, white has kind of a small edge without any risk. So I can play a lot of things. I mean, CD, Queen B6, even H6 is probably a move. CD, Knight takes D4, Knight C6. That's like probably the main line. But I don't think it really offers black much like in terms of winning chances. Crichton says, I like this opening. Is this a particular opening for black? Well, my idea is to play c5, and after d5, I play b5, which is called the Blumenfeld Gambit. But there are a lot of other moves I can play. This bishop g5 he played here, it's a very rare move, and I haven't studied it, to be honest with you. So I'm kind of on my own. I think I encountered it once the other day, and didn't really know what I was doing. We can transpose to some sort of maybe book positions. Queen a5 check, bishop d2 or queen d2. Again, nothing special for black. Bishop b4 check looks like a solid move. And knight c6. So you can kind of take your pick of those moves, I guess. What's that? William, was the opening playable with bishop f5? I like to take the bishop out of the pawn chain. Yeah, Stefanos, that's the normal strategy. I think you missed d take c. In my opinion, that line really equalizes for black when white plays d3. So with your move order, you had that option. I should have played queen b3 instead of d3, and we might have got a similar position. But the way I played it sort of tricked you, because I played d3, then you played bishop e7. But instead of bishop e7, you should play knight to d7. And that would, you know, transpose to the games that I talked about. Black is basically equal in these variations. I'm just going to play... I'm trying to move illegally. I thought he moved. Guys, we're streaming till 9 o'clock. It's 8 o'clock now. I also do videos on YouTube. My channel there is Video Chess Training. We've got Demonolith, Blartwitch, who just likes challenging me but doesn't listen to the stream. Cosine 180 and Beater 101. Beater 101 with a 6-3 challenge. That's kind of cool. So, okay, knight takes c6 here, and generally speaking, that's like in the Sicilian. It's not really a good exchange. It's a powerful piece on d4. If I take, he centralizes the queen. So you just kind of have to ask yourself, like, what's the point of exchanging on c6? Just trading pieces for the sake of trading pieces? Not usually a good, you know, a good reason. So I'm going to play a very solid game here, bishop e7. I'm keeping my pawns kind of fluid. I might play d6, I might play d5, depending on the situation. Cosine says a queen a5 looked interesting because a queen d2, bishop b5, knight c3. You know what, Cosine? You're right. I totally spaced. You're totally right. I did neglected to say this at all. Queen a5 check, queen d2. Bishop b4, knight c3, and knight, yeah, that's actually good for me. So I guess queen a5 is the best move, and white has to play bishop d2, and it's probably about equal. So I think Cosine figured out our problem there. We forgot that after queen e2 we can play bishop b4, and he has to play knight c3, and then we have a good game. So yeah, that's a terrible little oversight by me. Queen a5 check, bishop d2, and then I move the queen back to b6, and it's probably about equal. Yeah, good call, Cosine. Thanks for letting us know, because, you know, honestly, that's pretty bad for me to overlook that. Okay, here, it's reminding me of a Sicilian now, like some kind of e6. Variation of the Sicilian. E5 is a transferal of pawn structure. That looks okay in this position. Not the only plan, though. And a little risky, because I have some backwardness along the d-file. But we met this pin here very, very powerfully and very well. So I could even play knight d5 here. Trading like a bad piece. Knight d5, bishop takes e7, knight takes e7. But it's a little too fancy, so I'm just going to castle. Future GM, chess GM. Why are all the nice chess players so far away? Yeah, this is looking like a pretty standard kind of position now. Akin to some variations of the Sicilian, where white plays bishop d3 and trades the knight on c6. What are we going to do? Knight e8 comes to mind. It looks a little passive, but I could reroute it to c7 and into e6. Let's try it. Something interesting. Let's try to be a little creative. He's got pawns on white squares in the center, which means that his dark squared bishop is the better one. Now here, he did the right thing. He avoided the exchange of bishops. So I don't know, man. I mean, maybe he's going to play c5 here. So I could play d6. Is there any other thing I could do? Like queen a5? He plays a3, and I think that's bad for me. I could play c5, very weakening my structure. Probably have to play this. Looks like white's slightly better now. Feels like I made a mistake. White has a slight edge here. I don't know. I guess knight e8 was a little too passive. In retrospect, I could have played bishop c5. It seems weird, though. Had a very similar game against Prohashka, who's now a 2600 GM. Well, is it my turn again? Man, you're moving pretty fast there, Emmanuel. Bishop c2. That's why he wanted to play 5-0 or whatever. Did knight takes e4 win a pawn? Ooh. What? Knight takes e4, bishop takes e7, knight takes c3, bishop takes. I don't know, man. It might have. But I don't have time to think about it because Jorge is faster than me. It might have. I get a little groggy sometimes after the first hour and a half and I'm talking and not really concentrating for tactics, but I think white really missed some chances here. Now maybe c5 and just establish a piece on d4. Bishop g5 doesn't really work. Maybe I'll go for this. It's very committal. Gives him a square here too, but we're at least equal, I think, once we lock it up. And I already misplayed the position. There's no question. I think he had c5 for several moves there. So if he just does c5, black is better. I think I misplayed it for sure. Now bishop g5 is still an option. Doesn't really do anything. He could just not exchange. Tough position, very blocked, honestly, guys. Tough position for both sides to make progress. Gives up the dark squared bishop here. I'm going to take toward the center, which is more standard. And he plays f4. Looks a little risky, weakening his dark squares. He's playing for time, it feels like. I'm going to challenge him directly with f5. Manuel Jorge, man, just does not use any time. Well, I think I hallucinated. Okay, so he wins material. Whoa. Man, this is getting tricky. So we sacked the pawn here. Okay. Maybe we just... Man. Who... E4, pawn takes e7, pawn takes d3. E4, pawn takes e7, rook takes rook, rook takes rook, pawn takes. He wins a piece here? Is that it? Rook takes. like Emmanuel just smashed me. Maybe my king can hide in the center. Looks like I'm getting mated. E4, pawn takes E7. Rook takes. Takes. Pawn takes D3. I'm just losing a piece there. So we have to try something. Was this a rated? Oh, it's rated. I forgot, of course. It's a rated game. No, I just figured it out. I understand now. Okay. Yeah, no, I totally didn't realize it was rated, of course. Now we understand. We understand. Yeah, insta moves, like, one after another. Congratulations, Emmanuel. Congratulations, man. Man. Game over. It's totally game over. I had no idea it was rated. Terrible. Yeah, I might as well just give it up. No time. We might be actually doing okay here. Just enough time to, like, save it. But it's still very complicated. A draw is the best I can hope for. Probably the best I can hope for. Now he's taking time. Emmanuel Jorge is even taking time to, like, make moves on the board. He's even taking time to, like, comment in the chat room. You've got 3 minutes to my no time. Can't afford any more mistakes, and I'm down a pawn. Rated game. Didn't realize. Why don't you guys warn me before it's too late? I'm just la la la, you know, talking about it. Like, girl 2D blue trainer. Have you met someone who is a titled chess problem solver? Well, you'll have an affect, right? You'll kind of affect. The Israeli, yeah. He's like a chess-solving GM. Or maybe composition, I'm not sure. Subjectively, his position is not real close. I mean, it's pretty close. But with the time aspect, I guess Manuel Jorge is going to take me out in rated play. I'm answering questions with like 8 seconds. It's like ridiculous. All right. Sorry guys, no time to think, no time to talk. Try an active move here. Alright, let's just try to take him out. We got two bishops. Right, we could be ahead here. We could be better. Could be mate. Time is equal. How about the position? Now, you guys need to tell me that it's like a rated game, though, a little bit earlier, because seriously, this, you don't want to cut it like this close. The rated game with a guy who's like 600 points lower. GG, man. Time isn't everything. Demonolith, what's up? 3 second increment. We can come back from the dead with the 3 second increment, but I think with like the 1 or the 2 second increment, it would be probably terminal. 1 second increment, definitely terminal. 2 second increment, yeah, I'm usually toast. But that's what we're talking about earlier, guys, about playing for people's time pressure. 3 second increment, it's very, very tricky. Demonolith, is this rated? No. Okay, you have established ratings. Good. All right, we're going to play some kind of normal King's Indian. They warned you from the start. Yeah, I just wasn't paying attention. I missed it. You need to, like, type it in, like, caps, in, like, rainbow-colored caps or something. Uh-oh, Bishop G5 against my D6. Kind of a random position. Maybe Knight D7, not that great. He played knight d2. It's a little passive. I would think knight c3 is a little sharper. A little bit of a sharper attempt for white there. You typed it in caps, but not rainbow. Read your chat. I played an Indian kid in bullet chess in person. I almost lost. He learned that from Hikaru, man. Knocking over the pieces. Yeah, but I guess there's a lot of really, dilettante sort of blitz players now who've never played, like, they're like GMs in, like, computer, like, online blitz, but they've never actually touched the pieces, like, in real life. There's probably more and more people like that are just, like, uncoordinated, and they could be, like, 2900, but they still can't even, like, not knock over the pieces. It's probably something that's seriously gonna happen a lot in the future. Freedy, what's up? We were screaming rated. I missed every time. Yeah, all right, guys. Well, that was a good wake-up call anyway. We avoided the streamer hunting grandmaster and narrowly, like, took out the sneaky rated player. Managing to save my rating for the day. And Emmanuel learned his lesson about trying to flag people. I'm trying to move twice in a row. Flicker Alex, welcome. Guys, the next stream will be Thursday, and after that, we're streaming on Thursday and Friday, 6:30 p.m. Friday, lately, I've been doing a simul. So, this is an interesting setup from Demonolith. he's not committing himself, like, to playing e4 or e3. Queen c2 is kind of tricky. You know, I play the same basic position with, like, pawn on e3, pawn on c4, knight on c3, and against the King's Indian. He's got a similar type of setup. Not as aggressive, though. You know, when you play c3, knight d2, it's essentially like a collie system. Maybe he's going to try to castle queenside. So I'm not, you know, I'm not really in a hurry to, like, commit myself to castling just yet in this position. Another approach you might try would be, like, pawn takes pawn. But it's not very exciting, is it? So, although there's nothing wrong with castling, it's a totally sound move. Thinking of alternatives. But I still, you know, I would like a square for my queen. I'm so used to playing the King's Indian, honestly. This is more like an old Indian. I'm so used to playing the King's Indian that I'm afraid to play c6. Because you have your bishop on g7, and the d6 square becomes very weak all the time, chronically. But, you know, since I'm not really used to this old Indian type formation, I'm thinking, don't play c6, don't play c6, because the c6, you know, creates a d6 weakness. But as long as the bishop's on e7, you know, c6 is actually a really okay move. DST said, you should try and make a living being a YouTube streamer. Just post a video of you eating Weetabix without any milk, so you'll get as many hits and views. That's what it comes down to, really. You know, what is our goal? To try to have the most viral video on the internet, or just try to teach people how to play chess? Well, chess is my best thing. I mean, poker was close. I think I'm still a little bit stronger in chess than poker, objectively. I mean, I put a lot of time into poker, too. I say this especially because, you know, DST is actually interested in poker. A lot of chess players are. I was professional poker full-time, like, for the last 8 years until 2015 December, basically. And that's another thing. But if we're going to work on something, we're going to work on it. You know, if we're going to do chess, we're going to do chess. If we're going to do poker, we're going to do poker. I found myself always unable to kind of do both. When I was doing chess, it was really focusing on chess. When I was focusing on poker, chess was just like a thing on the side. Some people can do two things at once, but I like to really concentrate on one. All right, he's played e4. That's a tempo down now. He's sort of cut off this diagonal. He doesn't have the like diagonal threats with bishop d3. So I'm thinking a castle now and maybe queen c7, normal like rook e8. It's looking like a kind of dry Tory attack. Not very exciting position, but we keep the pieces on the board. So if I want to beat a lower rated player, this isn't a bad kind of setup to play because you keep pieces on the board. You also have this personality, and I tend to devote myself to 100% for whatever you're currently into. Yeah, that's the way I was with chess for many years till I started doing poker, and then that took over. And my chess was terrible when I was doing poker. I would play like online chess sometimes when I was bored. I'd be playing like 10 poker tables and like trying to play blitz at the same time. It never really went particularly well. I found the chess though could help sometimes to kind of say I was playing a lot of online poker tables at the same time. Maybe throwing like a blitz game in there to keep my concentration. I didn't care if I won or lost the blitz game so much, just to kind of keep my mind fresh. But in general, yeah, focusing on really improving at one thing, I think that's, you know, that's difficult. There are people like Magnus Carlsen's trainer, Simon Agnestein, who he was a professional football player and professional chess grandmaster. But I guess, you know, he would do, like, soccer, you know, in one season and chess in the winter or something like that. I can't imagine, you know, being a professional athlete and a professional chess player at the same time. you'd really have to divide your attention. Anyway, guys, if you don't know me, I'm International Master William Paschall. We're streaming from the United States now. At the beginning of September, we're going to be moving back to our country of residence, Hungary, where the streams will be CET, so Central European Time. By the way, guys, who was it? Cosine 180, did I miss knight takes e4 that game against Emmanuel? Really? Was that a tactic where I had... knight takes e4 for sure? Sironche says, 10 poker tables, 4 tables already make me hyper. Yeah, Sironche, I mean, there was a time when I was doing sit and goes, and I was a supernova on Poker Stars. So... in order to reach supernova, you have to play a lot, and especially if you're not playing high stakes, if you're playing like mid stakes, you have to play massive amounts of tournaments. So I used to play like 20 tables at my, you know, maximum. It's a lot, you know. I can do multitasking as long as it's the same type of task, you know, but trying to do chess and poker simultaneously is quite difficult. Okay, so white's not really doing anything here. I'm thinking bishop f8 and just turn it into a king's Indian. Get this rook a little more active. But maybe that's the wrong idea. I mean, I could try to exchange his bishop on g5. You see, like Petrosian, the Armenian world champion, he always focused on the strong point and keeping powerful control over that strong point. So our position is a bit passive. The whites, you could argue, is the same. But we have very good solid central control. And again, white's been a little passive here. I'm thinking of playing b5, but you know, then things could get interesting if white decides to play c4. So I don't know if I want to, you know, open that can of worms, so to speak. A5 a little more tempting to me because I'm getting dark square control consistently. I'm a player who plays the King's Indian. I play the Accelerated Dragon. Maybe A5, A4, just kind of getting some space. Grabbing some space with a rook. Got to play these kind of positions sort of intuitively. Did you get to play Zoom or are you more of a tournaments, normal tables person? I never really got into the Zoom. I stopped playing like sit and goes. Well, I don't play a lot of cash, so you know, just sit and goes. So Zoom was never really an important option. But I played sit and goes for a long time and multi-table tournaments, and I only play cash with friends live or sometimes like at tournaments, but Zoom is, yeah, it's okay. It's sort of fun, but I guess if you're a cash grinder, then Zoom is really important, you know, if you want to grind a lot of volume in poker, but I just occasionally would like play a Zoom tournament or something. But it's always weird because in Zoom tournaments you don't really have a chance to use the information about your opponents, so it's much different. Yeah, anyway, that's the poker discussion for today. Running out of ideas. White's not doing anything, and maybe we're going to have to do something sooner or later. Rook B8, kind of a weird move, but what can you do? I don't know where to put my pieces, and I'm going to grab some more space with B5. Just going to start taking space sort of randomly. There's actually some similarities to this position you might think about the Roy Lopez, for example. So there's some similarities, like in the King's Indian, Roy Lopez. All over the map, guys, aren't we talking about poker, chess, Roy Lopez, Old Indian, King's Indian? If you guys are interested in lessons, send me an email. My email is videochesstrainer@gmail.com. I forgot to mention that. Also, again, my YouTube channel, Video Chess Training on YouTube. From September 1st, I'm going to be creating more like unique videos for the YouTube channel. B4, this is an interesting move, and I think it's pretty heads up by white. Honestly, when I take my rook off the A file, he plays it in that moment now, when he still could have played it because a4 wasn't well protected. But I think overall this is an interesting move. What's the drawback? Maybe I can take on d4 here. And if he takes with the pawn, I take the pawn on b4. And if he takes with the knight, he loses his control over this e5 square, maybe. Maybe I'm making a concession here, though. I don't think I thought this out properly. Not great. I shouldn't make this exchange yet. Maybe prepare it somehow. Wow, he's taking with the pawn. And he's going to try to play e5, it looks like. So we can play h6. This is going to be very, very scary. h6. Wait, that's the big center. Got to be very careful here. I don't want to lose my h7 pawn with check. Looks like white's got something, but I have knight h5. That's my justification. If he had h3 in, I'd be like, well, I'm in bad shape here. But with knight h5, at least driving him back to bishop e3, I grab on b4. I'm not sure what's going on. So it's at least kind of unclear. If he could play bishop h2, I'm probably in big trouble with this e5 threat hanging over my head. How much lessons would I need to take to be better than you in chess? Biased in the sample size of games we have played. That's difficult to say, man. Difficult to say. I mean, I've played, quite a few games, but not that much with you to really be able to answer that question. I just feel like I really need to know a player really well. I mean, it's never easy to actually make someone better than you, but I could probably, get you to my level. It's like, can matter be created or destroyed? Man, now Demonolith trying to kill me here. My knight is now totally in limbo. He's threatening to win a piece with g4, but we have knight takes e5, and I don't see the knockout here for white, honestly. I don't see another move. I guess I could play nothing. I mean, this is really a threat. I could play knight c5, no. Knight b6, maybe. Stop g4 with bishop g4, but knight b6 is... Doesn't seem as appealing as winning a central pawn, does it? So queen takes is viable. Where's the queen gonna go from there? Back to c7, I guess. Rook takes, is there any value in rook takes? Rook takes knight f3. Oh, he can play bishop takes h6, but I mean, I'm winning like two rooks and a bishop for a queen there, so I don't see how that really makes sense. Now c5? Knight f3 quickly played. We have to be careful. I may have to give some material back here. Man, I hate to do that. What am I going to do? I hate to give the material back. But I'm going to have to. He didn't play bishop takes c5. You've got a golden opportunity. Did not take it. Bishop g4. Yeah, so Dimonolith, yeah, he had bishop takes c5, and not really sure what's going on there. He's still hanging on, but I'm going to simplify this, and in this opposite color position after knight f4, we don't need to go into that. I mean, bishop d6 looks like, or b6 maybe, just b6. solidify trading rooks or not to trade rooks. Probably doesn't matter. Bishop d6. Big target here. So it looks like white's in trouble. Not only materially, but positionally. And queen e5 drops f7. I don't want to drop f7. So we'll seal off the position. And we gotta find a way to win. Alright, let's not lose on time. I'm down to 10 seconds myself. This guy is... Wow. He's a blitz player himself. Speaking of holy increments, be careful where you go. I feel good. I get my knight. Get my knight in the game. B3 is a threat. Dude is milking this increment. He loves the increment. We should be fine here. Two pawns up has got to be a win. He's not making too many mistakes, though. Not too many mistakes. And shouldn't this B pawn just win? Now we got the king position. But I'm sure I could have played this better, guys. Absolutely. B3, B2. How about this? We get the C pawn rolling. The pawn duo. And that's it, man. That is it. Finally. No way to stop those puppies. Just get the pawn duo. And we're good. Demonlish, though. Demonlith. With a... another increment, a dangerous player with the tricking you into thinking like he's capable of losing on time. He is not capable of losing on time. You can rest assured. You can grab another pawn, but it seems kind of greedy. Queening squares. That is mate. I'm not going to underpromote to a rook. That would be underpromotion. Not cool. Blar Twitch doesn't listen. I told you, man, 5-0 is not on the menu. Cosine 2401. Getting up there, man. We're going to play a little e4. Justice Bot Rage played all the time with trackpad. Justice Bot Rage played, or just Rage? Justice Bot Rage. It's a different person than Justice Bot. Yeah, don't start playing Bullet. It's not necessary for your game. The only thing you need is some Blitz to keep, you know, to keep the game. There's no need to play. I mean, I don't mean to take away from DST. He loves Blitz. He loves Bullet, and it's cool and it's great. But I just don't think it's necessary to play, you know, anything faster than 3-0. I mean. It just doesn't seem necessary, you know, if you want to improve in chess. I think once you get to become a GM, then you can do like, you know, Larry Christensen and start playing some 1 minute, but just when you're bored. But before, until you get to the point where you're a GM, probably it's best to concentrate on playing longer games. Before you get... Sledgy, how much lessons would I need to take to be better than you at chess? You're asking me the same question. Wait, you're copying DST's question, right? How much lessons would you need to take? Well, I mean, I think if you took lessons for, well, there's no guarantee, you know. I mean, the problem is you have to do the work yourself, you know. It's not just about lessons, isn't enough to make you. I can't make you a GM, you know. I can only help you, or be better than me. I can only help you, you know. That's half the work. I mean, you guys have to realize that's only half the work. You have to do it yourselves. Okay, cosine here. Interesting play. So help yourself, man. I mean, this pawn is so commonly sacrificed in the Sozin. I think, you know, I can just sack this pawn without even calculating here. Knight c6, though, would change my calculations a bit. Now we probably have to defend the pawn. F4. F4, knight takes d4, queen takes d4 is okay. Actually, f4, d5. Thinking about f4. We got time here, 6 minutes, guys. Knight takes c6 would give us another move to increase the build-up, but what do we do after that? We can play knight takes c6, bishop takes c6, f4. Looks kind of lame. Knight takes, and then bishop takes a rook e1 also seems lame. So what is a non-lame move for white in this position? Bishop e3, developing a piece? I think so. And that looks pretty standard. Black's position, not really standard. I mean, he's played this very quick a6, b5, and bishop b7, leaving his king in the center. Kind of a tiny bit risky, I would say. But I don't see anything I can do concretely. My setup with A3 is a little bit rare. I don't know who like invented that move, but it's something that I play from time to time. Kind of takes people out of book usually. And it's not a bad move. Speaking of Larry Christensen again, I don't know why he's on my mind so much today, but he plays A4 instead of A3, which is slightly more weakening, but interesting. So bishop e7, no sacrifices on e6 because he can just take on d4. So f4. I guess. F4, knight takes d4, bishop takes d4. Knight takes e4. No, he can't do that. So I guess f4 is fine. I mean, he could do it actually, but it looks kind of risky. Yeah, there's some complications here. Knight takes d4, queen takes d4, knight g4 is not on because of queen takes g7. That's a problem for black. I could take with the queen and play something like king h1 next move, sidestepping knight g4 type of ideas. So if his king was castled, if his castle was castled, he could play normally knight takes d4, queen takes d4, knight g4. And forced me to like give up my dark squared bishop or something stupid like that. But here he isn't castled, so that's I can take with the queen on d4. Also interesting is knight takes d4, bishop takes d4, knight takes e4, where I like sacrifice a pawn. But I didn't really see anything clear there. Bishop takes g7, rook g8 could actually be dangerous for me because black has pretty scary threats on the file. So I probably have to play something like f5 and try to attack him without taking on g7. Dr. Robotvinnik. All right. We're talking about bullet chess over there. Christensen gave a Simon Day in Boston. That's why I remember him so often. Yeah, well, he's all over the place. Who's Chilled Chaos? I don't know, guys. Stefanos is a YouTuber. Okay. So the question is, queen takes d4, or do we go with... sacking a pawn here? This is not a rated game, but I want to try just as hard. Queen takes d4, safe move, probably followed by king h1, or bishop takes d4, sacking a pawn. But then again, he could just, after bishop takes d4, just castle, not take the pawn. So I think I like queen takes d4. It develops a piece, and the follow-up is simple. I mean, I'm going to play king g1, king h1, which is a useful move anyway. But I like the way that black played this. It feels like very fluid. I never had any kind of piece sacrifices on e6. However, now is f5 an option? I mean, can I let him play like knight g4 anyway? We can't play knight g4 and just ignore it. So f5 is an option. Could be a strong option for white here. All right, what else, man? I'm going to do f5. And the problem is, oftentimes I play the same kind of exact same position with this bishop on b7 on d7, which is obviously less aggressive, but better for black defensively, because he can protect e6. In this position, it's more like, yeah, he's got to do e5. And now the million-dollar question is where to put my queen. All the squares are viable. Actually, they're not, because he has knight takes e4. I have to go here. All right, never mind. So it looks like a fairly standard position. This black is equalized. I guess black is equalized. I'm not 100% sure. Interesting situation. So what does he do here? I know what I would do, but I'm not him. Rook c8. Okay. So now the new thing is knight d5, he takes on d5, and I have to take with a pawn. And it's a pretty boring position, actually, where white doesn't really have an edge. So I'm thinking let him sack the exchange. I mean, that's fine by me. He's not going to double my pawns. And I'm not sure if he has enough compensation. So we're going to play rook c1. Let him sack the exchange if he wants. And that would be unclear. But otherwise, we keep control of the position. There was another move, bishop g5. Maybe there he sacks the exchange. I don't know. More effectively, yeah. If bishop g5, maybe rook takes c3, queen takes c3, knight takes e4 kind of shot. So, still, he can sack an exchange and have compensation. Not sure what's going to happen. It's it looks like unclear. But I don't know what else to do. He could slowly get squeezed if he doesn't do something dramatic. It's not a move I really like playing. But it's the only piece not in the game. Rook f2 is too awkward. It might get hit by knight g4. I sound very relaxed. So, yeah, this is probably what I would do with black, but I wouldn't be confident, because if you smashed my pawns with, like, b take c, I would be really worried about white's position. But here, I think that white should have at least equality. So, now there's the big question of what to do. I mean, he's probably going to reinforce his center with this move. And then I guess I could think about something like c3 to fight against center, or rook d1. He's going to play d4. A very quick d4. What can we do to stop that, or like discourage d5, d4? Queen e1. Well, we don't have a lot of... Man, I hate when it does that. We don't have a lot of squares to go to. D3 or D1? E1. Alright. Try to slow you down. And then Black's in this situation where he doesn't know, you know, if he wants to, he doesn't really know if he wants to play d4 or not. My pieces are pretty well placed in the situation, about as well as they can be placed. We might have a threat. There's always f6 in some moment. Maybe. We could also usurp his knight with bishop b1. Start thinking kingside. Kingside. Love. So, I'm liking it, man. I mean, I think I'm liking white better. Maybe just because of the time, but I've been on this end, you know, this sort of the black side of this kind of position fairly often, and you know, his pieces aren't as well developed. So now what? F6, nothing there. There's always bishop B1. Or we could increase the pressure on the D5 pawn. I think I'm going to take this clear route. He's not trading pieces, okay? That's cool. Gotta watch knight g4. h3. King h1 comes to mind. Yeah, that's probably not a bad idea. Kind of double-edged, because he does have a bishop on that diagonal, but yeah, that's what he's thinking too, it looks like. I've got a bishop on that diagonal. Well, pawn takes pawn, queen takes. And what's the idea? Like, I don't really know. I mean, I'm going to call his bluff here. Queen d5, okay. Well, I can protect the pawn. I mean, I don't know what else to do. Queen g1. Cosine, really. Now things are different. Okay, he's threatening, like, nasty stuff with that. So why don't I go here? All right. Queen g3. That's the money move. Defending g2. Oh, wow, he's got an answer. All right. So I guess I'm going to have to take this before something really bad happens. F6, rook e1. All right. So I'm still up a pawn when all is said and done. Alright, well, he just lost on time. I'm not convinced about this position. Pawn takes pawn, rook takes. Black has compensation, so let's say black has compensation. Guys, it's almost over. I think I'm going to play one more game. I didn't really call it, you know, how many players I'm going to play. But we're going to play one last game because I didn't call it. Beater 1662. Beater 101. Guys, time to go. The time has been so fast. It went by. We had so much fun today. I didn't even announce when I was going to quit. But usually I say, oh, like two more players or something. Last one today, Cosine. You got disconnected. Sorry, man. I thought you just, you know, gave up because it was a casual game or something and you're a pawn down, but you know you have compensation. GG. I want to thank everybody in advance for joining me here. I'm going to wrap it up with this game against Beater 101. It is not rated. He has kind of new account. Though he's not 2490. The mysterious Grandmaster who challenged me. When he gets to like 2800, we'll see if he's still challenging me. Okay, so been working on this a little bit. I almost like routinely castled, but that allows the Berlin variation. So let's try something else. Avoiding the Berlin. Working on a video series on another site I work for, chesslecture.com. Uh-oh, bishop e7, bishop takes knight, knight takes pawn, and we win a pawn, no? Actually, I saw this happen in a game once. Alexander Ivanov was playing white against some guy, and it was sort of funny. It was a Harvard Open long ago. Just drop the pawn, you know. I think that black has like a third of a pawn compensation here, probably, based on the fact that he has like a bishop pair. But he can't really allow this. I think against queen e2, like, if I play queen e2, you can play bishop e7, maybe sack a pawn, because the position of my queen is pretty vulnerable. But against d3, it's too solid for white. You can't just sack the pawn. Against d3, you need to play either actively with like bishop c5 or d6. Not really that many moves, actually, for black. This is a good move. Good call, man. I think that bishop b7 is the only really viable move there for black. That's the only move that makes any sense to me. Then you can play d6 and kick my knight out. And you have the bishop pair, and you have like a tiny bit of compensation for the sacrificed pawn. So good job like finding what is basically like your only chance. And now knight c4 is tempting. Tempting move. Looks a little like vulnerable to getting hit though with d5. Not sure if I should play knight c4 or knight f3, or knight g4, just trading pieces actually kind of makes some sense. Gleitson, William, I need to know now before I would like to know if I Friday will have the simul. Yeah, we're going to do a simul as we did the last couple weeks on Friday. Yeah, let's set it now. So Friday, 6:30, we will have 25-30 player simul here on Lee Chess. Beater here now giving me a second pawn. I'm gonna probably bite because this looks unsound. I have at times declined pawns like this, but I mean, it's his king side. It is gonna be wrecked. Well, you might get a little bit of compensation if you can somehow get your king like castle queenside and try to use the g file to attack. I wouldn't resign in a blitz game, probably. You're two pawns down, but you can still fight on. All right, Gladstone, man. Take care. Cosine says, computer says the exchange sack was sound, but I needed to play d4 instead of bishop g5 slight edge to black in the end there. You were winning at some point with a weird queen a7 move. Yeah, I agree. I didn't like bishop g5 cosine. I was scared of d5, d4. So in the final position, what did it say? You're better? Or like, you mean in the end of that line where you play d5, d4? What time zone? 6:30 p.m. Eastern Time. We will be doing a simul on Friday. And Thursday we have another normal like blitz and bullet, my God. Blitz and classical. What are you doing to me, DST? 6:30 p.m. Thursday, blitz and classical. That's Eastern Time. And 6:30 Eastern Time p.m. Friday is simul for like 25, maybe 30 players this week. Okay, bishop d7. Let's get developed. What happened? You just did bishop d7, bishop c8? Was that a mouse slip? Are you sure you want to do that move? I just wanted to offer him a take back, but I guess he doesn't have take backs. So we're just gonna keep going forward. I think that like putting the bishop on g3 might be one defensive setup to stop any kind of threats he might have on the king side. Obviously, I have e5 busting it open in the center. Serocche, yeah, New York time, more or less. No longer Hungarian time zone. I've been in the summertime. I'm usually in the US. July and August, I'm in the US. The other 10 months of the year, I'm in Budapest. I think we have to donate to see Sladgy playing a bullet tournament. Yeah, you're going to have to donate. DST's already tried to bribe me, but it's pretty expensive. It's pretty expensive. I mean, plus you have to consider the practice time I'd have to put in. It's been years since I even played like 2-0. I occasionally played like a 1-1-0 game, like, but it's really bad. I'm very, very slow with the mouse. All right, so e5, this. He does have bishop h4, but it shouldn't be enough to salvage this position. And this is over. After bishop takes e5, I'm trading off one of his bishop pair, and it's totally lost. Now I lost a rook. So, beater 101, it wasn't pretty. You felt a little bit of discomfort after losing that pawn on move 4. Not used to people playing d3 against your Berlin defense. I know. I know how it is, man. You couldn't take my pawn on e4 and you freaked out. That's the way they all are. I don't want to play the white side of the Berlin defense anymore. It's like hopeless. Thanks again, guys, for joining me. Again, we'll be back Thursday with Blitz and Classical Chess, 6:30 p.m. Eastern Time, New York Time, whatever. Friday, simul, Eastern Time, New York Time, 6:30. Cosine said, I like the Sozin I played. My opening theory in the Sozin only goes as far as knight d7, knight c5, take the light squared bishop. So what do you mean you agreed and never responded to my email? I did say I agreed and you never responded to my email. I just said, that's not what I said. What did I say? Confusing me, man. I never responded to your email, but I never like promised I would do it. Okay, game over. So here we go, guys. Girl, 2D blue trainer. You learned a lot. Well, that's the point. So that's why we're doing it. If you want to watch people play bullet chess, that's another story. But look, we have even bullet players here who admire us for what we do. Chess is chess, right? Doesn't matter what the speed is. Chess is still chess. Thanks for joining me. So we're out of here. We'll see you guys Thursday, 6:30 p.m. Thanks, everybody, for joining me. Once again, would appreciate a resignation at this point. Yeah, it's good enough. Thanks to the game beater. So I enjoyed it today. Thanks, Soroche, for doing the troll maintenance. And we will be back Thursday. So I hope you're not busy weightlifting, Soroche. And we'll see you Thursday night. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye.